It's a very real fear, an asteroid hurtling through our solar system, avoiding the protective gravitational tug of our best friend Jupiter, and revving up like a Super Saiyan Goku right through our atmosphere before plummeting straight into the deep blue sea. Boom, hellfire and pain, and 90% of the Earth's population snuffed out from existence. It happened to the dinosaurs, heck, it probably happened a few times after that too. Our society is obsessed with the thought of an extinction-level asteroid event, or well, the Hollywood heroic avoidance of one. Armageddon, Deep Impact, and a million other B-movies that paint the picture of a post-apocalyptic, post-asteroid society. Well, what would that world look like? How would the few survivors maintain their fragile existence? Let's find out, shall we? Hello, internet, and welcome back to the most inquisitive channel on YouTube, Life's Biggest Questions. As always, I'll be your disembodied floating voice as we look to the skies, shield our eyes from the brilliantly bright, blinding light, and curiously ask the question, what if an asteroid destroyed 90% of Earth? Roll the clip. Now, before we approach the latter half of this question, we have to first paint the picture of the initial asteroid impact event. The actual devastation caused depends on quite a few factors, such as the size, speed, angle, and landing point of the cosmic destroyer. If it's 10 feet across, in all likelihood, it would skip across the atmosphere like a far-flung skimming stone and burst into a pretty little fireworks explosion in the sky. 100 feet across and people start getting a little twitchy, and it would cause a massive explosion like the one witnessed at Tunguska in Russia on the morning of June 30th, 1908. If it's a quarter mile wide, it would take out an entire region roughly the size of Virginia, and the subsequent fallout would be a game changer for how our civilization developed into the future. And if it's 10 kilometers wide, then we're all pretty boned, and the ones who are initially vaporized by the global impact are the lucky ones. And that's the asteroid that we'd be looking at to answer this question, likely being flung out from the Oort cloud, a thick bubble of icy debris that surrounds our solar system. An extinction level event, the end of all things, the big rocky herald of the likely goodbye of humanity. Bye. At 10 kilometers wide, the asteroid would travel at around 30 kilometers per second, which is roughly 90 times the speed of sound. Unlike smaller meteors, an asteroid that size would be unstoppable and have no semblance of slowing down as it traveled through our atmosphere. It would punch through in less than 3 seconds like it's not even there, like a hot knife through butter and all other synonyms that relate to things passing through things with ease. Like a perturbed ghost through a wood-paneled wall. You get the picture. Either way, when it hits the surface, it would hit so hard that it wouldn't even matter where the point of impact occurred. Land or sea, it's not good, guys. Most people within a 100 mile radius would either drop dead from the initial concussion of the compression wave, or perhaps even more likely, be completely vaporized by the wave of destruction and devastation. And you know what? That's possibly the most comforting end. They're the lucky ones, because they would most likely never even know what hit them. Because what would remain would be a world much worse than The Road, Mad Max, and The Walking Dead combined. There would be nothing left. It would be the literal definition of a wasteland, and the 10% of Earth's remaining population are in for a pretty tough remainder of their fragile lives. The energy of the impact would likely vaporize a large amount of the Earth's crust, throwing all of the subsequent ejecta into the air, unleashing devastating winds across the planet filled with debris and rock and destruction that could reach more than 1,000 miles an hour. Umbrellas ain't gonna save us this time. Unimaginable earthquakes would follow, shaking the planet to its very core, and likely bring ruin to our most iconic cities on a global scale. The ejecta would continue through to the atmosphere, heating up to temperatures possibly near 900 degrees, aka that sweet, sweet melting point that turns lead to liquid. It would trigger global forest fires and likely cook anyone and anything not sheltered deep, deep underground. But 10% of Earth's population is roughly 750 million people. And, well, that's a lot of survivors to throw into this equation. And a lot of people who were smart, concise, or lucky enough to get shipped into a deep underground bunker to shield them from the years of destruction waging its way across our fair planet. Essentially, it would be the plotline timeline of 1998's Deep Impact. But what we're concerned with are the years that would follow, if, of course, our underground safety bunkers did their job and we didn't succumb to chaos and mutiny inside, killing each other in a frantic post-apocalyptic existential panic. I'm looking at you, Vault 19. The combination of dust, debris, and soot from the ejector's influence would remain in the atmosphere for several years, blocking out the sun, and without the glorious power of our solar overlord, praise the sun, the vast majority of Earth's plant life would die, and as a result, the entire food chain would collapse. So we better hope that our bunkers are stocked with some highly resourceful agricultural technology, because we wouldn't be growing anything out in the open for quite some time. Also, pizza is probably off the menu, and don't even get me started on what a bleak existence that would be. But, and as always, this is a very big but, there is hope for us all. Humanity is a very resilient species. It's the reason that we are who we are, and the reason that we've managed to clamber through the primordial soup and build colossal monuments into the sky. A survivor population of 750 million would bring us roughly back to the global population of the 1600s, a time where humanity was shaking off the shackles of feudalism and stepping out into a brave new world. With the same population, we'd essentially be given a fresh start once a decade or so had passed and the planet had began rejuvenating its delicate yet resilient ecosystem. However, this time the survivors would have the foresight that humanity's future is fragile, because they've seen the consequences, they've lived through them, and the fear of a similar man-made catastrophe would become the benchmark that would rebuild our civilization upon. Unfortunately for them, the dinosaurs never had a second chance, but maybe, just maybe, we would. Well, there we have it, folks. Why don't you let us know your thoughts in the comment box down below. Before we depart, let's take a look at some of your more creative comments from over the past few days. Malik Jones says, "Hi Danny Burke, sorry if I spelled your name wrong." And hey Malik Jones, no worries buddy, it's spelled J-A-C-K-F-I-N-C-H. I know, no worries, it's a tough one. Super Frankie says, "Old music was better." But on the flip side to that, Fugs Wells Mind says, "New music? About time." So, I guess the struggle continues, and it remains the same that you can't please everyone at the same time, right? Well, unfortunately, that's all we've got time for in today's video. Just for sticking around all the way till the end. If you're a fan of this video, make sure to hit that thumbs up button, as well as that subscribe button, and we'll be seeing you in the next one. As always, I've been your disembodied floating voice, Jack Finch. You've been watching Life's Biggest Questions, and until next time, you take it easy.